All right, what is up, my friends? Again, in this strange week in which you only have videos to watch, no live session, this is our second of our week 9 recordings. And again, like I told you for the video that you watched yesterday, it's really important that you devote good, considerable time, energy, and focus to these videos because it's the only time you're going to have access to this content. Because next week we'll jump right into Jacksonian democracy and the next elements of period 4. So, like I said yesterday, if you need any help, if anything's confusing, if you want to reach out, I'm available all day, every day. You just let me know what you need and I'll be happy to jump on a call and do what I can to support you. So today we're talking about really one of the key outcomes of the Jeffersonian policies, of the War of 1812, of the Era of Good Feelings. And that is the early industrial revolution in the United States, often also called the market revolution. Now, when we think about the phrase market revolution, what I want you to think about is that people begin buying and selling and producing and consuming goods from faraway markets. I don't mean markets like a grocery market or a store down the street. What I mean is that people are no longer containing their local economy locally in a small sphere. So people might be now, instead of growing grain and bartering whatever extra grain you had with your neighbor for part of his hog, right now people are growing grain in larger scale so they can ship it farther away and sell it. So the whole economy becomes much more interconnected nationally as opposed to the small regional localized economies we see before. And that's why the second part of this title is descriptive, in that it identifies that this era, which we can really look at 1815 to like 1850, is America's first industrial revolution, and it's the creation of a national economy, an economy in which policies are enacted that affect the entire nation and different cogs of the nation's economy are going to play a different role in moving forward economically. So really, this process is going to begin with Madison. And Madison, as you know, we spent time last week on Madison just regarding foreign policy, impressment, and the War of 1812. But Madison's also going to do a couple things that are going to signify, A, the moderation of the Democratic-Republican Party as he embraces some Federalist-type policies, specifically on economics. B, we see Madison understanding the consequences of the war and these years of impressment and embargo and the like as kind of kickstarting a more industrial economy, and thus embraces some policies that will further the development of an industrialized economy, much to the chagrin or annoyance of a Jefferson who's very annoyed by this, but he's not president anymore, so we don't care. And C, Madison really begins looking forward in the economy in a way in which he's able to embrace like the future of the American nation in a way that maybe some former presidents were not as akin to do. So the first thing we associate with Madison post-War of 1812 is the Bank of the United States. Now, as you know, the bank was a Hamiltonian idea during the Federalist period, part of Hamilton's financial plan. The bank had expired, right? The bank is not forever in the Constitution. It is constitutional, according to a loose interpretation, but it's not in the Constitution. So the bank had a charter or a term of years that it would operate for, and that charter had expired, and the Democratic Republicans just let it expire because they're not big fans of a national bank. But towards the end of the War of 1812, Madison looks at what's happening in terms of like inflation and state banks just publishing and loaning money and printing money, and there's no real control over inflation and the economy and the money supply, and he authorizes the charter of the Second Bank of the United States, the Second BUS, which is the acronym I'll use a lot, this unit. And that's 1816, and he gives, and Congress authorizes a 20-year term, keep that in mind for next week, it'll matter, a 20-year term on the Bank of the United States so that this new era of bank will last from 1816 to 1836, a 20-year term. All right, so that's the first thing that kind of helps facilitate a more national economy, and now we have a national banking system to try to regulate currency and the economy in a way that's really challenging to do without a national set of organizational regulations. Second, also a Hamiltonian idea, is the Tariff of 1816, which I talked about yesterday. which is the first protective tariff in U.S. history. And when I say, again, a protective tariff, that means that it's put in place to protect domestic industry, to encourage Americans to buy industrial goods from America by putting an import tax on industrial goods from overseas. Right, the way I often explain this in class is if you have two TVs that you're looking at, one is $200, the other is $250, and they're largely the same TV, we're going to buy the $200 one because it's cheaper. Now, sure, that's logic and common sense, and I hope that you can make those kinds of smart financial decisions in your life. But what if the $250 one was an American business and the $200 one was a Japanese business? Now we're spending our money in supporting a Japanese company, which is just fine, which is just fine. That's why protective tariffs are taxes added on imported goods that makes the imported good more expensive and thus not forcing you, but it encourages you to buy the American good. So then imagine a $60 tax on all imported TVs, right? Now this $200 TV from Japan is $260, and now the $250 one from the US is looking a little bit more attractive. So that's what the protective tariff is supposed to do, is protect American industries, and these growing baby industries need protection because it's hard for them to compete with the industrialized English economy that has done this for much, much longer. Now, the tariff is very popular in the Northeast, where industrialization is going to take place. The tariff is very unpopular in the South because the farm economy of the South doesn't benefit from the tariff because they have to buy their goods from somewhere anyway. So all it does is make a TV that was $200 they could have bought from Japan in this case, although nobody's buying TVs in the 1810s. Make sure I'm clear there. Now it's making their goods more expensive, so the South is upset about the tariff, which again demonstrates the Democratic Republicans embracing a more moderate view on the economy and not their strict interpretation, which would have been anti-tariff, anti-bank. And we do see Madison also approving of some internal improvements, some federal funds for infrastructure, for roads. The Cumberland Road gets approved, and we'll work to connect the Atlantic seaboard with the western stretches of the United States. But we do see Madison vetoing some, or we know the president has the power to take legislation that Congress passes and veto it or cancel it if he doesn't like it. Vetoing some federal funding for roads and canals and improvement of waterways and the like, because he says that Congress doesn't have that authority. Right? We have the power to regulate interstate commerce, but not to use our money to facilitate interstate commerce. So here Madison embraces a looser interpretation, but still does fall back on the Democratic Republican ideology on some things. Right, it says here in his veto message, the power to regulate commerce among the several states cannot include a power to construct roads and canals and improve waterways to promote and secure commerce without yada, yada, yada. So moral of the story is that Madison's policies begin the process by which America will industrialize, but a lot more things have to take place. Right? And a lot of this is in line with what I talked about yesterday. That's Clay's proposed American system. Henry Clay is the idea man behind a lot of these concepts. It is Clay that proposes the American system in 1816, which includes that bank that gets approved. It includes that tariff, which gets approved to promote U.S. industry and to limit the importation of British goods. It proposes federal funding for a national system of roads and canals, so we have a better system of infrastructure and a more interconnected economy, transportation-wise. And we do get our bank, we do get our tariff, and the roads, canals thing ends up being a little bit of a sticky subject that we'll talk about into next week as well. Cool. So this American system is important. It helps us frame or contextualize background information for how and why this market revolution takes place. And let's talk about these things, right? The three elements are in your notes of Clay's American system. The first is a protective tariff. Why? To promote, to protect, to help domestic American industries. That's reason one. Reason two is to generate federal revenue, right? If we're going to charge a tax on imported goods, some people are still going to buy their goods from overseas. Fair. That's their right. This is a capitalist society. When they do, they pay that tax to the United States government, and then the United States government has more money in federal revenue as well. So it's looked at in some ways as a win-win. It's heavily supported by northern industries as they're going to use this tariff, the protection from this tariff, and expand greatly. The money being raised by the tariff is going to mostly subsidize or pay for new roads, new canals, new bridges in the north. And an auxiliary or a supplementary positive is that the South and the West should benefit from an industrialized North, because that industrialized North will be consuming more raw materials and more crops, which makes a lot of sense, right? Like, if the North industrializes and the South just making cash crops, whatever those cash crops may be, then ideally you have a system in which the cash crops of in the South are being turned into manufactured goods in the North, and thus everybody wins, right? However, these tariffs are heavily opposed by the West and the South, because the tariff raises prices on manufactured goods, and Southern plantations and farmers are going to deal with foreign competition, meaning that when we put a tariff on imported goods from England, England might put a tariff on imported goods from us, and the only good England is importing, right, they're not importing our manufactured goods, they don't need that, but they're still importing our cash crops. So if they put a tariff or a tax on our cash crops being sent to England, that hurts the South. The South's looking at this like, the tariff hurts us, and then if England tariffs us, that hurts us too, so what the hell? The Bank of the U.S., the goal there is to manage or to control the federal revenue, all the tax money and the money the government has, to regulate national credit. So we see like local and state banks loaning out money to whoever the hell wants it, and that's a very dangerous way to run an economy. So we're going to regulate the idea of credit so that only people are only borrowing money that they are probably should be allowed to borrow, to help facilitate commerce and trade, and just as importantly, to stabilize and regulate the national currency, meaning to not print too much money to cause inflation, to make sure the dollars are worth something, etc. Now, its support comes from the desire to democratize the credit system between Eastern banking establishments and the Western and Southern farmers who want credit. So instead of like having just wild card banks that are just running a loose system without any regulations, it's supposed to create a more uniform structure there to avoid speculation. These people, like we talked about yesterday, that caused the Panic of 1819 by just speculating or gambling on Western lands. It's going to limit that, and thus supposed to limit economic panics by keeping the economy more stable as opposed to up, down, inflation, too much borrowing down, inflation, too much borrowing down. Now, it's opposed by those who argue that it's not constitutionally legitimate. The government doesn't have the authority to do this, and thus they shouldn't. And it's opposed because it is perceived by some as consolidating or holding wealth among the banking, I shouldn't say banking, they're not baking anything, the banking and the industrial elites in society. So the bank is part of this important move to modernize the American economy, but it does have some opposition as well. The third piece of Clay's American system is internal improvements to improve the country internally, infrastructure, roads, bridges, canals, etc. The goal here is to create more official transportation for commerce, right? Less about like travel and going on vacation, much more about getting our goods and our trade in and out and around the country in a more efficient manner, right? By clearing roads, by digging canals, by establishing turnpikes, by taking like existing harbors and digging out the bottoms of them so that they're deeper, so boats can come in more easily. And thus to connect regional markets, right? Like the economies of the North and the South and the West should be much more interconnected. And if we're going to interconnect them, it has to be via transportation. Clay's goal is to subsidize or to pay for these things via the federal revenue. The federal government's going to pay for it, generated by land sales, as again, the federal government, like they were earlier, is selling land in the West, and by tariffs. And its support, the idea of it is that it's supposed to fulfill the idea of the government working to sustain the public good and the general welfare. It's going to keep the economy moving forward, but it is opposed by some, as always, as too much power in the hands of the federal government over the states, and it benefits the wealthy at the expense of the common man. So that's Clay's American system. It's never like presented as one neat package, but it's Clay's vision for the economy. Looks a lot like Hamilton's financial plan in many ways, and it's going to play a pretty key role in facilitating the economic development that comes with the market revolution. Now, at this time as well is the continued influence of the Marshall Court. Now, we talked about John Marshall during Jefferson's presidency, right? He's appointed by John Adams. He's a Federalist. He's the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. And even though the Federalist Party is dead, like, Supreme Court appointments are lifetime appointments. So John Marshall is actually going to serve into the 1830s as the kind of the last bastion, the last hope of Federalist ideology in the federal government. And he's going to rule in two really, really important cases. I mean, he's going to rule in a lot of important cases. We talked about Marbury versus Madison for judicial review in 1803. Vitally important. No judicial review, no none of the rest of these things. But in terms of economic development, there's two cases that he rules on that are incredibly important in this era. The first is McCulloch versus Maryland in 1819. Now, Maryland, the state of Maryland, they established their own state bank, and their state bank attempted to charge a tax on the Bank of the United States branch that was in Maryland. The argument there was that there... the bank is in Maryland, and thus it's under Maryland's jurisdiction, so Maryland could tax the bank if they wanted to. The real murky undertones of this case is the question of, like, A, is the bank constitutional? And B, who has supremacy to tax who? Do the states have the ability to tax the federal government, or is it the federal government that can tax the states? Where does the supremacy or the real power lie? So in this ruling, a vital ruling, Marshall and the Supreme Court rule that A, yes, the bank is constitutional because it falls under the necessary and proper or the elastic clause, and because it's necessary and proper for carrying out the duties of the government to control the finances and the economy and everything else, the bank is constitutional, it is allowed. And two, B, whatever, A or one, regardless. A, constitutional. B, the states are not allowed to tax the bank because the bank is an institution of the federal government, and the federal government has supremacy over the states, right? The Constitution includes that supremacy clause that says that at the end of the day, the final power rests in the national government. And John Marshall says, it's a very important line, the power to tax is the power to destroy. Meaning, if we let the state governments tax our national institutions, then we're giving the states the power to destroy the national government, and thus we're violating the supremacy clause. So that makes the bank constitutional. It also sets the precedent that the federal government can enact policies that are beneficial for economic growth, whether or not they're explicitly listed in the Constitution. The second court case is Gibbons v. Ogden in 1824. Gibbons v. Ogden, 1824, which dealt with a boat, a ferry, that was going back and forth from New Jersey to New York across the Hudson, the harbor right there, that kind of close to like where the Statue of Liberty is today. Wasn't there then. And New Jersey, the state of New Jersey, had granted this boat company a monopoly to be the only boat who could take this trip from New York to New Jersey, taking people and goods and the like. Right? New Jersey gave them a monopoly. They had the sole permission to engage in this New Jersey to New York commerce. Now, this gets sued all the way to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court under Marshall says, no, you can't do that because your boat is going from New Jersey to New York, and because it's going to two states, only the federal government can regulate interstate commerce. Only the federal government has the authority to regulate commerce between states, and thus New Jersey giving its little steamboat company the power to have a monopoly over this commerce was unconstitutional. So in both of these cases, what ends up coming out of it, and almost all the Marshall Court cases, is an increased authority for the federal government at the expense of the state's rights. So all of this is going to contextualize the changes that are going to lead to the expansion of the American economy. America is going to experience an improved transportation. We're talking about all these things, some rapid technological innovation, some new inventions, a much increased national economy, a huge wave, our first big wave of European immigration post independence. And all this is going to fuel the desire to continue doing what's happened during the Jeffersonian period and continue expanding westward. So the first thing to talk about is transportation advances. We see the two big advances you should note in transportation. First is steamboats. Steamboats are a big deal. Check us out. Up to this point, everybody on a boat, you're either rowing. You're rowing your way up or downstream, or you're using wind, right, with sails. Steamboats is the first real type of engine you can put on a boat. The idea of the steam engine is brand new and invented and exciting. The steamboat is invented by Robert Fulton in America. Robert Fulton is a good name to have in your back pocket just in case. And steamboats, it's going to sound really dumb, enable people to really transport goods up river, right? Now you don't need to worry about rowing against the current and you're rowing your ass off and not going anywhere. No, like what we see with steamboats is you can just take an engine and go upstream, right? Think about like riding your bike, right? Riding your bike up a hill is not fun at all, right? But if you had a motorized bike, wouldn't matter. In this case, steamboats are going to make a really big deal. Canals make a big deal as well as we start building like artificial rivers to connect important cities and waterways so that commerce becomes much, much easier. Of course, this is the era before cars, before airplanes, before UPS, right? So water is the easiest way to transport things. But going upstream sucks until we can create things like canals and steamboats that make this much, much easier. Now, up to this point, the Mississippi and the Ohio rivers were really helpful for getting goods out of the United States because they flow from the internal U.S. out to the Gulf of Mexico. But in terms of getting goods back to that part of the country, it was very, very, very difficult. So if you moved out to the West, like it was easy to sell your stuff, which is really hard to get stuff. So there's up to this point, there's no real good way to get manufactured goods to the West. But Robert Fulton's invention of the steamboat helped connect the West and Northern manufacturing. And we also see a bunch of state-funded, state-directed canal projects, the most famous of which you need to know, because College Board loves it, is the Erie Canal, which is going to be designed to connect New York and New York Harbor and New York City with the Great Lakes region in the West. But these state-directed canal projects are going to cut shipping costs. They're going to make shipping 90% cheaper between the West and the North. So these transportation advances are making it just the way I often put it in class is they're making the world a smaller place, meaning that the world hasn't shrunk at all, but now what maybe used to take 8 days takes 2 days, and thus the world is, relatively speaking, smaller. We see how much we're saving in money on how much it costs to ship things. Right, we look at wagon rates as the most expensive way to ship things because it takes the longest. You have to go over land on a wagon. Upstream river rates, like how much it costs to ship something upstream. Look how much that's going to drop because of the steamboat. It's way cheaper to ship things upstream. Canals also become cheaper once there's more of them. Downstream river rates are going to drop as well. The very tail end of this period, we start seeing early railroads. So we're seeing transportation advances making life easier for economic development. And this backs that up, right? Like this shows us how long it took you to travel, right? The color coding shows you, and this is all from New York City, right? Where you can travel in 1800. In 1 day from New York City, 1800, you can make it like from right there to right there. Wow, that's a long way. Whereas compare this, now you're talking about a way farther travel circumference in a 1 day period. The 2 day we see even more drastic change, whereas the 2 day here, right? So we're seeing that because of advances in technology and transportation, Americans are able to get places way, way, way quicker, right? It used to take 4 weeks to get to the Ohio River. Now you get to the Ohio River in 1 week. So we've cut it down 75%. Not bad. And this is going to facilitate more commerce, more trade, more westward expansion. Because when people know they can get buy and sell their goods, they do so. So the inventions, I talked about innovations that make the economy move at a more rapid rate here too are also important, right? First, we talked about the steam engine already, harnessing water power to create industrial capacity. On Western farms, we see the new mechanical reaper, which is going to be a horse-drawn machine, basically. That is going to take grain and sift, I don't know what the hell grain does, but sift it, sort it, cut off the parts you don't need, and make it more way easier to harvest crops. The spinning jenny is going to be used in northern textile mills and textile factories to take cotton and turn it into cloth, into goods. So that's going to make things much, much quicker. Eli Whitney is going to invent the cotton gin, which is going to make cotton the world's most valuable and most planted cash crop, which we'll talk about in a little bit. John Deere, maybe you've heard of that company. It still exists to make trailers and whatnot. It's going to create the steel plow, which makes planting of things much, much easier in challenging dirt and soil. And a lot of this is going to take the ideas of Eli Whitney's interchangeable parts, which he first uses on a gun. And then he then applies these ideas, and I'll tell you to say what it is, of interchangeable parts to his cotton gin. And then we see it being applied to a bunch of other new mechanical innovations as well. And what interchangeable parts means is that if one piece of your machine breaks, you shouldn't have to replace the entire machine, because that's really, really expensive. I think about this like with my car. But if I was driving to school today, which I wish I was, and I got a flat tire, I would just replace that tire. I wouldn't buy a new car. That's ridiculous. Likewise, one of the obstacles to industrialization up to this point is that it's expensive and the machinery is expensive. It's a big risk. But if you can create a system in which if something goes wrong, you don't have to replace the entire machine, just one the part that went wrong, it's less of a risk. So Eli Whitney's idea of interchangeable parts is going to play a huge role in making it easier for people to get into the industrialization game. So as we can see, like the steam engine is going to have a big impact on the northern economy, the mechanical reaper more on the western economy, the steel plow in the west and the south, the spinning jenny in the north, the cotton gin in the south. Moral of the story, the different economies are all going to benefit from these innovations or inventions that are going to facilitate economic growth. So with all that being said, this is what gives us our first industrial revolution, early American industrialism. And like most things, we're still absorbing a lot of our ideas from England, right? The two things that come from England that really facilitate this, the first is steam power, which we've talked about. And the second is their factory system of taking steam or water wheels on a river to spin machines to make things happen in a factory setting. Both of those things are going to come from England. But despite these ideas coming from England and all the benefits the U.S. economy has, the U.S. really does industrialize really, really late compared to other countries, England specifically. Why? Reason one, land, right? So many Americans came to America because there was land here. They came here to work their own land, to embrace the yeomanry ideals, right? That I don't want to like work for no boss. I'm going to be my own farmer, do my own thing. And since land was so abundant and so cheap in America, most Americans see no reason to want to go work in a factory for somebody else. They can just get their own plot of land. They can farm some stuff. They can mind their own business. They can do their thing. Second reason, not a lot of money in America, not a lot of capital to invest, like to build a factory, to buy all this machinery. Not a lot of liquid assets that can be used to create a more industrialized economy in America. Most people are self-sufficient. They're just doing their own thing, minding their own business, and they're bartering or trading for whatever else they need, which means that there's not really a need or a supply of funds to industrialize. The third reason is labor scarcity. There's not a lot of people that want to work in factories, right? There's not a lot of labor because people wanted to work on their farms, mind their own business. This is going to be solved largely by Irish immigration in the 1830s and 40s. Fourth reason is that it's really hard to compete with the British, right? The British companies are incredibly established, are very, very, very well run, very efficient. And we, late to the game, aren't going to be able to compete with them on a large scale. So people were like, why try? And the last reason is that a lot of these secrets stay in England for a while. The British don't allow their mechanics or their machines to leave the country at all. They want to protect the fact that they have this, not monopoly, but they have control over the industrialized production, really, of the world. And Samuel Slater is an important name as well, kind of the father of the American factory system. He's actually smuggled out of England. He's kidnapped and smuggled out to America. And he brings all the ideas for the British factory system in his head. It's pretty impressive. It's pretty impressive. So those are the reasons why these things are delayed. But by the 18, slowly, like post-embargo act and war of 1812 and the tariff of 1816, things start moving in a much more industrialized direction, and much of that's going to be fueled not by anything industrial, but by cotton. Now, we know just from a little bit ago that Eli Whitney invented the cotton gin. Fair. Cotton is not a new crop by any means, but cotton was very labor intensive, meaning it took a really long time and a lot of effort to harvest cotton because there's spines in it, there's big seeds in it, there's all kinds of prickly stuff. It's very difficult to work and just to get to the soft, fluffy, nice cotton stuff that you see like cotton balls and the like. What the cotton gin does is it allows a person to turn this machine, and this machine pulls all the cotton out, discards the seeds and the spines and everything else, and it makes it way more efficient to harvest cotton. Now, what this means is that cotton becomes the most profitable crop in America, the most profitable crop in America, and thus we see a huge increase in Southern expansion to the West. So the Southern society, where we see the cash crops being harvested, expanding westward in a rapid desire to spread out to farm more cotton. So as we can see in 1790, right after the Constitution, every dot on this map represents 200 slaves. So we see the slave population in the Southern United States is really clustered here in the Chesapeake, Virginia, and here in South Carolina, Atlantic Seaboard. 30 years later, due to cotton expansion, we've seen slavery gets dispersed south and westward because of cotton. By 1860, it looks like this. So again, each pink dot represents 200 slaves, but now we don't even see dots here in South Carolina. We just see giant blobs of pink, which all represent hundreds of thousands of slaves, right? Through the upland areas of Georgia and Alabama and Tennessee and Louisiana, as well as still in the Chesapeake. And this becomes known as the Black Belt, this little area, right, where all the slave population is concentrated. And it's because the soil is so dark and so rich and so perfect for farming cotton that the soil itself is like black. And this leads to a huge increase in slavery in the Deep South, a huge expansion of slavery as the Southern economy becomes completely intertwined with cash crops, cotton specifically. By 1860, we're going to see that numerous states in the South have a massive percentage of their population as slaves. I look at South Carolina, has over 50% of their population as slaves. So does Mississippi. Louisiana is really close. Alabama is close. Florida is close. Georgia is close. The Deep South becomes increasingly reliant on slaves because of cotton. Now, the founding generation, right? We talked about how Jefferson talks about how slavery is. You know, it's a necessary evil. It'll die out eventually. We are starting to see in the 1790s a potential decrease in slavery, and that slavery is becoming less profitable because tobacco is less profitable and the soil is becoming way more over-cultivated. We've been farming tobacco in the same place. So there's a brief window of time in which maybe slavery is going to be phased out, and then cotton happens. And then once cotton happens, the renewed desire and demand for slaves is going to fuel this southwestern expansion. Another way to look at it here, this is 1820, the slave population, each black dot representing 2,000 slaves. There's 1840, right? And here's 1860. All right, so I tried to lay it out so that you could still see the black dots for 1820, so you can kind of see how it expands and where it expands. And you're seeing it expanding along this black belt strip right here in the Mississippi River Valley, as well as in the Ohio River Valley up in Tennessee and Kentucky. So really quite sad, but it's cotton that fuels this entire Industrial Revolution, and this cotton is all harvested by slaves. So if we look at the idea of like an interconnected economy in the 1840s, by the end of this time period, the antebellum South, we're going to start calling this era, sorry, I should have said this earlier, is going to be referred to as the antebellum era because it is before the war and starting to preview towards the Civil War between the North and the South. Antebellum South is going to be dominated by cotton production. This is going to divide society very, very sharply on some specific class lines. Cotton production is going to divide society into the large plantations, the big landowners with lots of slaves getting really, 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 really rich, and the poor yeomanry, the small, contained family farms with few or no slaves, are not really engaging in cash crop farming. They're engaging in mixed commercial farming or subsistence farming, trying to just get by. So we see, like, this again violates the Jeffersonian ideals of, like, self-sustained, self-sufficient, everyday farmers being happy, because big money plantations are dominating the Southern economy. Now in the West, right, this circle that I have here, our antebellum West, we're going to have a lot of cheap land. A lot of cheap land is going to drive a lot of people out to the West. And settlers that are moving to the West are, of course, not going to be, like, rich people or people with a bunch of money, but just people looking for cheap land and a way to create self-sufficiency for their families. These settlers are going to transform the West from a raging wilderness to cash-producing farms. Much like the middle colonies of the colonial era, they're going to produce breadbasket or food-type crops like wheat and corn, raising hogs and cattle. This area of the country is going to feed the nation. And because of better transportation, because of canals and bridges and roads, it becomes much easier for the West to get their goods to the market, and as well as get goods from markets to their farms as well. Now, in the Northeast is where we're going to see the actual Industrial Revolution happening. But it's important to note that, like, the Industrial Revolution can't happen without the cash crops from the South and the food from the West. So all these parts are equally invested. It's just that the industrialization part happens in the Northeast. So we're going to see still a good chunk of farming happening in the North. But in the North, we're going to shift from yeoman farmers of self-sufficiency to small commercial farming. Again, this reflects the idea of the market revolution. People are no longer producing goods just for themselves and their neighbors. They're producing goods to sell in a commercial setting, in some sort of a market sense. The antebellum North, the Northeastern states, are going to start making manufactured goods like plows, like mechanical reapers, like cotton gins, like textiles, cloth, clothes, for farmers in the West and the South. And it's there where we're going to see the first example of rapid urbanization, people moving to cities in large numbers for these industrial jobs. So by the 1840s, we're seeing our northern factories are really mass-producing textiles. And textiles just means cloth or material, right, textiles. And they're going to be taking southern cotton and turning it into textiles, which is a manufactured good. They're also going to be producing farm equipment and other finished goods. But the real dominant economic output of the first early industrial revolution, the market revolution, is textiles. Right? And because of all these new factories, we're going to see an increase in American cities, largely in the North as well. And it's going to become known as urbanization, the process by which cities become more urbanized core around factories or work or whatever it is in the city centers. In 1820, before all these changes take place, we see America has a couple big cities, right? New York's the biggest, Philadelphia's pretty big, Baltimore's pretty big, Boston's not that big, right? By 1860, look at this though. By 1860, we see way more big cities on a way bigger scale. Philadelphia's huge, New York is huge, Brooklyn, which is next to New York, is huge, Newark, which is New Jersey, across from New York, is huge, Boston's much bigger, Providence is bigger. So we see in the Northeast, way more big cities, and this is fueled by urbanization, fueled by industrialization. There's factories and jobs in these cities, and thus it's also going to be fueled by immigration. All right, so what is the impact of all these rapid changes on society? First, women, right? Textile factories are going to allow women the first opportunity to work outside of the home. We see women working in factory jobs in large numbers in the early 1830s, into the early 1840s, the most famous of which are the Lowell Mills in Lowell. It's a city in Massachusetts where women are going to come from the countryside. They're going to live at these factories. They're going to work at the factories. They're going to supposed to have like classes in school and development in these like factory towns. In reality, the women are often worked. You're going to read a short excerpt of a mill girl's diary after my video's over. It's in your handout today. But it gives women the first taste of some sort of like economic freedom and independence outside the home because they're not working on their family farm. Many women are going to work in these factories until they get married and then become housewives. But then society, after seeing women working out of the home, is going to embrace like a new generation of Republican motherhood, which is going to be called the cult of domesticity. The cult of domesticity, which is going to encourage women to maintain control of the domestic sphere and let men go do the working and the ugly parts of life. But as we see women getting married at a later age because they're working, and industrial work families as opposed to farm families require less labor, so we're going to see people having fewer kids, birth rates begin to fall, which allows much more child-centered families, right? Instead of having like 16 kids running around all working on the farm, people having fewer kids, so there's more time to like raise those kids and give them more attention in theory. And that's going to kind of all fuel this cult of domesticity that we'll talk about in a little bit. It looks kind of like this. Oops, I went too far. The growth of factories is also going to create a bunch of jobs. Those jobs are going to attract immigrants. And we're going to see our first real big wave of European immigration, other than colonization, obviously, in the 1840s. We're going to see millions of Irish people, largely because of the Irish potato famine, as well as millions of German people are going to immigrate to America to work on these factory jobs. Irish immigrants, this is an important distinction, Irish immigrants are largely going to work in these factory jobs, and they're going to replace the women that were working because they're cheaper. German immigrants are largely going to move to the West, places like Minnesota and Michigan, looking for farmland. So that's both groups are going to come to America really the same era, but they're going to settle in different regions of the country. Okay, so these consequences on women is this idea of the cult of domesticity. Women embrace the idea temporarily of working outside the home before society says we don't like that, back to the domestic sphere, which is going to create the idea that society should have separate spheres, meaning we have our public sphere that's male-dominated, politics, work, the economy, etc., and our domestic sphere at home, which should be softer and woman-dominated. The idea that comes out of here also, the cult of domesticity is also known as the cult of true womanhood, is that women should embrace piety or faith in God, purity of their actions, submissiveness to their husbands and to society's demands of them, as well as domesticity, running the home, running the domestic sphere. A very influential at the time ladies' book that women are reading, Godly's Lady Book, has this excerpt that's just painful to read, which says, "There is more to be learned about pouring out tea and coffee than most young ladies are willing to believe." Right, so just this encouragement of women to embrace just what a husband gives you and make the home your own. A picture that kind of reflects his ideals of the cult of domesticity is this. Obviously, the man is there reading or working on some sort of accounting, and with a Bible verse, right, that it reflects the piety piece. "Ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and ye shall find." Matthew, I don't know. I'm not good at Roman numerals right now. And then here's, right, wife's got two kids there. Girl over here is learning this way. We see a much more child-centered family and the ideals of the cult of domesticity. Now, the consequences of the immigration wave is going to be America's first example of nativism, our first example of anti-immigrant sentiment, nativism. Nativism is a preference for native-born Americans, thus anti-immigrant. This large influx of immigrants are going to inflame nativism in society, specifically against the Irish, because the Irish are going to concentrate in large numbers in northern cities like Boston and New York and Philadelphia. The Germans are going to settle out in the old Northwest Territory on farms. And what we're going to see by the late 1840s is a new political party, which we'll talk about later, called the Know Nothing Party or the American Party, who is working actively to limit immigration to the United States because they think that immigrants are ruining America. So go figure. The more things change, the more things stay the same. All right, we see this. examples of mob violence against immigrants in New York City, as one example. This is another great example of anti-immigrant sentiment, as we see the Irish immigrant who is portrayed as a barrel of whiskey, the German immigrant who is portrayed as a barrel of beer, and we see election obviously taking place as there's polls back here, people trying to vote, there's riots, things are going wild, and the Irish immigrant and the German immigrant are carrying off the ballot box. So this, of course, is implying that A, immigrants are alcoholics, and B, they cause violence, and C, they're corrupting our elections. So pretty important, pretty consequential. This piece as well is in your notes. I would ask you to analyze it. What is this particular cartoon trying to say about Irish immigrants and Irish immigration? So it's important that we understand that being incredibly anti-immigrant is a time-honored American tradition. Where the immigrant comes from may change, but the feelings of anti-immigration, anti-change sentiments, those maintain through the entirety of American history to today. So last, I'll close up with some of the key effects or the consequences. The effects on the social structure, the way our society is built, is there's this newfound belief that the poor could work really hard and get rich because of the American dream. And that reality is very greatly exaggerated. Meaning, for the most part, in the market revolution, those who were poor stay poor. And they become the factory working class. And those who had access to money, they're the ones who are able to benefit from this progress because they can invest it and figure out how to make themselves richer. The gap between the rich and the poor, actually, anytime there's industrial changes, this happens. The gap between the rich and the poor is going to get bigger as the rich get richer and the poor get richer too, but at a much slower rate. The wealthy before become the industrial leaders and the large plantation owners who are profiting off textiles and cotton and the like. But if we're going to talk about some positives, workers' wages do increase. People are making more money. The standard of living, everybody's access to goods, does get better. So it's not that like the poor are getting poorer and the rich are getting richer. It's that everybody's getting richer. It's just that the rich are getting richer at a way faster rate. This demonstrates true that there's way more economic opportunities in America than in Europe. Right? America can have a mixed economy, right? We have agriculture, cash crops, and industrialization, and like all because of space and resources and population. That there's way more opportunities in America, hence the immigration, than there is in Europe. For women, the effect is short-term. They are able to embrace some working out of the home, but then the cult of domesticity as a response of encouragement of women to stay home and maintain control of the domestic sphere. And then one of the big social effects, of course, is nativism and anti-immigrant sentiment. Effects on women specifically. Women now have at least a little more of an option in life. They no longer have to work alongside their families on their farms for their husbands or their fathers. Women do see an increase in control over their lives during this period, which we'll talk about in some reform movements in about 3 weeks. We're going to see a decrease in arranged marriages, an increase in women picking their mates. And we do see some single women who don't get married seeking employment in these urban areas that we talked about via urbanization. Women are going to get roles as teachers, as domestic workers, as factory workers as well. So women, especially those who don't get married by choice, end up with a little more control over their lives too. Economic effects. First, there's that panic I talked about, panic of 1819 yesterday. But despite that panic, we see, other than that little blip, pretty steady and aggressive economic growth for the United States from 1810 onward. This results in a very new era of the American economy. Before 1820, most families are simply self-sufficient, small, self-sufficient communities of farmers that farm what they need and trade for what they don't have. But the market revolution creates subsistence farming, transfers our economy from a subsistence farm economy, which everyone just kind of farms what they need, to market specialization, meaning people are going to focus on one crop and farm as much of that crop as possible to sell to faraway markets. After the 1820s, the American economy is forever changed. Right? The farmers of the South and the West are going to feed the workers of the cities in the Midwest and the North. They're going to provide them raw materials. the factories in the North are going to be able to create manufactured goods to sell back to the South and the West. So it's a much more interconnected, advanced economy. But by the time this period is done in the 1840s, the U.S. is still not an industrialized society, right? It was an industrializing society. The process by which we become a fully industrialized society doesn't happen until after the Civil War in the 1870s and 80s. Because by the 1840s, 60% of Americans still live on farms. So while all this happens, it happens and takes a long time for America to go from a fully like small farm economy to a fully advanced industrial economy. So those are your effects. I hope this was helpful. Make sure you read those texts that I included as well. They're not very long. Just to get your sense for what this is like. There's an anti-immigrant text. There's a couple cartoons. There's a woman from the Lowell Factories text. So make sure you embrace those. And let me know if you have any questions. Thanks, y'all. Love you guys.